Christ the radiant one took on the shadows of our hate, then rose again just as the sun with light and power and full of his grace. My song of life has reached the end. Though as a flower I may wilt, this everlasting truth will stand. No death or life could separate me of Christ my Lord. This hope is sure from age to age. My song will be
good morning. Good morning. Isn't it great to be in the house of the Lord today? Amen. I hear you, Brother Rod. Good to have you back with us, brother. Miss Judy, glad to have y'all back. But you know, with everything going on in our world right now, and there's a lot going on, I'm not going to stand up here and get into details about it. But just let me encourage you this morning. I hope everyone does take some time each week, each day, that they have alone time with God. And, you know, I've been with a lot going on in the world and everything. Lord keeps coming back and laying something on me, you know. Don't get caught up. I hope this comes out the way that I want it to come out. Don't get caught up with an elephant or a donkey. You understand what I'm saying? Don't get caught up with an elephant or a donkey. We serve the Lamb. And that's the only thing that's going to bring us through these difficult times. It's not what the elephant's going to do or the donkey's going to do. It's what the Lamb has already done. And, you know, if you read and study your Bible and you've read the last page of the Bible, let me tell you, it turns out great. Things work out perfect. Nothing takes God by surprise. He knew this was going to happen before it happened. And everything's going to work out the way that He wants it to work out. So just, as you know, pray, but don't pray for our will to be done, but pray for the Lord's will to be done. And with that being said, let me welcome everyone here this morning. Thank you for being here. There's a lot of other places you could have been this morning. You could have slept in. You could have been lazy this morning. But the Lord brought you here today, and He brought you here for a reason, and we're glad that you're here with us. Well, if you look at your announcements today, we do have a few announcements to make. The Operation Christmas Child Shoebox Dedication. Those shoeboxes are due by next Sunday. And we do have, I noticed there was a few people that brought them today, but those boxes are due by next Sunday. And also, I like what it says on here. It says, you prepare the box, and we, the church, we will pay to ship that box. So you just fill it up, you bring it back to church, and we'll make sure that we pay everything and get it sent to where it needs to go. Also, this coming Wednesday night, we will have our adult Bible study here in the gym. The children will meet in the family room of the Family Life Center, and the youth, we will meet downstairs where we always meet. And also, let me remind you to pick up your Home Life and your Mature Living. We do have those magazines back here at the back that we have available for the church. Make sure you take the time to pick those up and read those. There's some really good articles in there. And also, I don't know who worded this. I don't know if this is the preacher or if this was Miss Sylvia, but this is good. It says, are you a great cook? Are you a bad cook, but great at organizing? Are you bad at cooking and bad at organizing, but you can wash dishes and set up tables with the best of them? You are needed for the fellowship committee. The more people who are working, the easier it will be for everybody. Because once COVID is over with, we're going to go back to being Baptist. And what does that mean? As Baptists, what do we like to do? We like to eat, right? So we want to get back in here where we can start eating and we can start fellowshipping. But we do need you on the fellowship committee. If that's somewhere that you feel like the Lord's leading you to serve, let us know and we'll get you to the right person. And we can sure use you there. At this time, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, Lord, we do thank you for this day. Lord, we thank you for the many blessings of it. And Lord, we are so thankful, Lord, that we can come back into your house and freely worship you this morning. Lord, we thank you for our pastor and for Catherine, Lord, and thank you for everything that they do at this church, Lord. And Father God, just pray that you continue to use them in a mighty and special way. Lord, as we have talked about earlier, Lord, we've had a difficult week, Lord, here and a lot of things going on. But Lord, let us not lose focus. Lord, that you're still in control. Lord, you're still on the throne. And Lord, you never make mistakes. And Lord, nothing catches you by surprise. Lord, I pray that we always remember that. Lord, we do pray if there's one here today that doesn't have a personal relationship with you, then Lord, we just pray that today would be their day of salvation. Lord, we pray that everything that's said and done today would be pleasing to you. We ask you now to forgive us where we fail you. In Christ's name, amen.
Good morning. It's so good to see y'all here. You know, with all the stuff that's been going on this week, ain't it great to have a blessed assurance that we have Jesus and nothing else, nobody else can give us that assurance and that peace. We're going to sing Blessed Assurance, Jesus is Mine. Stand and let's sing. For the children's message.
Good morning. How are y'all doing today? Good. Y'all look good. So, what kind of sound does a rooster make? Wow, so like I've got a bunch of roosters in here. All right, do it loud. One more time. What sound does it make? Like really loud, like you want the ceiling to hear it. Go for it. That's good. Good job. Well, I'm going to tell you this morning about a story about a rooster, okay? You ready? All right, Rusty the Rooster had a very important job. It was his job to wake up all the animals on the farm. So So every morning he would stand up on top of the hen house, and as soon as he saw the sun peeking over the horizon, he would crow at the top of his lungs. All right, y'all make the sound. Good. Then all the cows and the goats and all the chickens and horses would what? Wake up. That's right. Well, one morning, Rusty was standing on top of the hen house, ready to crow, waiting for the sun to come up. He waited, and he waited, and he waited, and he waited. But there was no sign of the sun. He waited some more, no sun. Now, Rusty got really worried. So he went into the hen house and woke up Henrietta Hen and said to her, Henrietta, the sun is gone, the sun is gone. I've been out there all morning waiting for it, but it never came up. It's gone. Henrietta said, you silly rooster, the sun's not gone. You just can't see it because the clouds are covering it up. It's still up there above the clouds. Boy, was Rusty relieved. Then he started thinking about that, and he said to Henrietta, you know, that's just like God. Henrietta said, it is. Rusty said, yes. Sometimes when we have trials, it seems like God's not there because the trials get in the way, but he's still there. Think of it like this. The clouds come and go, but the sun is always there, right? Even on rainy days, it's still there. Sun's not there when it's nighttime. It's on it's the way we're turning. It's on the other side, but it's always there, right? But, you know, our trials come and go, but who's always there? That's right. Okay, so 2020 has been a rough year, right? So how has 2020 affected y'all's lives as a kid? Why? What's changed for you? Can't go to normal places. But you got to be really careful, right? Yeah. Can't go places you normally do. Can't visit friends. What else has changed? How many of y'all play sports? Has your sports world changed? Yep. You know, what about church? Has church changed?
Yeah.
Yeah, it has. Look around you. We're in a whole different building. I mean, you know, on Wednesday nights we have to do things a little different. We're doing Awana different. A lot of things are different. And we have to wear a mask. I mean, school's changed, right? I mean, y'all were on hybrid for a while. Now y'all are back together. But things are changing, right? 2020's been a rough year. And now this past week, our politics, everything's changing. But you know what? Through all this, some of us may say, well, we have no hope, but we do have hope, don't we? Jesus is always there, right? Even through the trials, even when the clouds are, we can't see the end of COVID, or we can't see, you know, when we're going to get back in the sanctuary, we're going to get back to our normal routine. Jesus is guiding us right through it, and we got to trust him, okay, in all areas of our life, okay? Just always remember, even though the clouds may come, God is always there, okay? All right, let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we just thank you so much for this beautiful day you've given us, Lord. And dear God, we do thank you, Lord, that you're a God that doesn't leave us in the hard times. That even though sometimes we feel like we can't see the light at the end of the tunnel, Lord, we know that you're there, Lord, and that this is your will, and nothing's a surprise to you, Lord. And we thank you, Lord, for loving us and guiding us and always being there with us. In your name we pray. Amen.
Now, what does those roosters say? Wait till next year. I can say it. This is equal opportunity, right? Clemson, Carolina, it's just been a rough week, hadn't it, all the way around. And so, isn't it good that God's in control? I tell you what, you look at that prayer list, there's so many names on it and all this, and I'm just going to add a bunch more names to it right now. And so as you take your prayer list, add the name of Brenda Parker, as she needs our prayer. It's been discovered she has bilateral breast cancer, so want to lift her up in prayer. Also, Johnny and Melinda Holtz, they asked that we remember Arthur Panther in prayer. He's going to have a heart valve replacement November 24th at Duke Hospital. Dwayne Hamrick had a biopsy done this past week, and it looked good. The doctor said what they did, it looked good and all this, and he'll get the results back this Thursday. So do remember Dwayne Hamrick in a special way. But Lois Hamrick's son, Bruce Hultsey, is in Spartanburg Regional, and he has a lot of different medical problems. And so we want to lift him up in prayer. That's Bruce Hultsey. Jim Fagan is going to be having a heart cath on this coming Wednesday. Want to lift him up in prayer. Raymond Yelton to see a surgeon. That spot on his toe is just not healing. And so they're looking about having to go and take that out. And so remember Raymond Yelton. Beth Ellis, want to lift her up in prayer. You're going to have the MRI done this week. And surgery very soon. She has a torn tendon, mostly affecting the hip area, and been very painful for her. And so she's going to be having this done. Also, we want to remember Jerry Sellers. We've been praying for him about his infection that he has. The infection numbers are down, but he's in a lot of pain with arthritis, and his PSA numbers are high. So he's going to be talking to a doctor about that. Jerry Sellers, lift him up in prayer. Also, Lisa Bailey. Lisa Bailey, her husband was on our prayer list, and husband just had a heart transplant up in New York. And now Lisa Bailey, his wife, has had a brain aneurysm. And so we want to lift her up in prayer. Also, Mark Harold is going to be having exploratory surgery on December the 4th. And so we want to remember him. I did get the right date, right? December the 4th, exploratory surgery. So we want to lift him up in prayer. And then you see the list that we have here, and we want to pray for our government. We want to pray for, the Scripture tells us, whoever is leaders over us, we got to pray for them. Pray for the leader we have now. Pray for the leader we may have. I don't know. God's still in control. I told somebody this. What would be the greatest thing in the world if it goes as it looks right now? That our new president and our new vice president walk in the White House and the Holy Spirit hits them. They fall on their knees, confess their sins, invite Jesus Christ into their heart. And they get right with the Lord. Wouldn't that be? Y'all don't seem too excited about it. Have y'all forgot that God is still in the miracle business? Do you think just because somebody's a part of one party or another party, they can't get right? Folks, we don't need the people get right or left. We just need the people get straight with the Lord. That's what we need right now. And so let's also be praying for our government officials, but somebody else we need to be praying for. And it's a prayer of thanks. And that's everybody that served in our military. If you're a veteran, served in our military, would you stand at this time so we can give you a hand? If you've served in the military, please stand at this time. Thank y'all. Thank y'all. This Wednesday is Veterans Day, and you see a veteran, you thank them over and over and over again, right? Please be thankful for all of our military and pray for those in service now. And so, and let's see. Roy, you're deacon of the day as you come. Do remember people out there are still hurting. COVID-19 is still very real. It's such a blessing to see those that have gone through it here today in church. But God is still working, and we still need to be trusting Him. Brother, come.
Good morning. First of all, I want to thank all y'all, the veterans and the ones that are still serving, because if it weren't for y'all, we wouldn't have the freedom we have today. And just thank y'all for being here, and let's go to the Lord in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, I just want to thank you for this day. Lord, I just come to you and ask you just to watch over our country. We've had it so good for so long, and now we're getting hit with what we're getting hit with, and I just ask you to just watch over us and keep us safe. Lord, I come to you and ask you to bless all these people that's on our prayer list. You know every one of them's names. You know every one of them's needs. And Lord, I just ask you to forgive of our sins. And Lord, I pray that if there's somebody in this church today that don't know you, that something that Walford says to them will touch their heart and wake them up and know you before it's too late. In Jesus' name, amen.
It's amazing how God, you know, brings the service together. Beth talking about the sun shining. So that's my song this morning, and we didn't even really discuss this before, so.
Lord, the light of your love is shining in the midst of the darkness shining. Jesus, nations with grace and mercy send forth your word, Lord, and let there be light. Lord, I come to your awesome presence from the shadows into your radiance. By the blood I may into your brightness. Search me, try me, consume all my darkness. Shine on me, shine on me, shine, Jesus, shine.
Beautiful job. Thank you there. What year was that song written? Do y'all remember on that date? Okay. That sounds like a song that I sang in a group with. Y'all don't believe that? 1987. No, that's not the one then. I actually sang in a group one time, but they just made sure to keep my microphone off. Okay. That's how they did that. And so I just want to make sure y'all knew that. And so if turn your scripture this morning, we're going to be looking at Genesis, the second chapter, verses 1 through 3. Genesis, the second chapter, 1 through 3. Folks, what's the big deal about this Sabbath thing? What is the big deal with this Sabbath thing? You know, Sunday set aside for a day of rest, huh? How many of you find Sunday being the busiest day of the whole week? Got to go here, got to do that, got to go, all these things that we try to accomplish on Sunday because we didn't have time during the other 6 days. And so you think about this. Is it that God needed rest? Some people said that that's God worked 6 days and God had to rest. No, there's a scripture that says that's not needed. Look at Isaiah 40, verse 28. It says, "Have you never heard? Have you never understood? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of all the earth. He never grows weak or weary, even after a week like this. He doesn't grow weak or weary. No one can measure the depths of his understanding." So some questions I need to ask you about this Sabbath day, this special day of rest. Could it be we have more leisure time than we think? Could it be? Now, some nodding their heads. Some folks said, "Oh, no. I don't have that much leisure time." Just walk into your garage. Walk into your storage buildings, wherever you are. Do you have a lot of things like golf clubs there? Soccer balls, softball equipment, all this kind of stuff. Well, any of you got a boat in the backyard? Maybe you hadn't been on it a long time, but you got a boat. I mean, always something. Think about it. How much time have you spent in leisure? I hadn't done anything like that. Have you laid on the couch for hours at a time watching football game after football game after football game? I can't do it either. I can go out and do something, come back and catch the end of it. So all this, could it be that? Okay, next, could it be that we do not really enjoy what God wants us to do on the Sabbath? We really don't like the idea of being still. We don't like the idea of listening to God. We don't like this idea of worship. Is that happening to us? Another question. Could it be that we are running from God and taking a whole day to worship and honor Him is like being in prison? Any of you ever been a Carolina fan and somebody invited you to go to a Clemson game and you sat there in the stadium and you were a nervous wreck? You were in the wrong place. Well, if you're a Clemson fan, you went to a Carolina game and you felt like I was in the wrong place. Is there a chance some folks are sitting in worship today and they're in the wrong place because they served somebody else instead of one true God? Could that be it? See, could it be that the Sabbath will be a burden when evil is in our hearts? Isn't it awful that some people sit in church and plan evil things for this coming week? Oh, that wouldn't happen, would it? I tell you what, things that go in our minds, we've got to be so careful about. What we can fall into and the trouble that we can get in so quickly. Evil that's in our minds. What's this all about? Let's stand and honor God's word. There in Genesis 2nd chapter, verse 1. Thus the heavens and the earth were completed in all their vast array. By the seventh day God had finished the work He had been doing. So on the seventh day He rested from all His work. And God blessed the seventh day and made it holy, because on it He rested from all the work of creating that He had done. And just look at that. And God blessed the seventh day and made it holy. Is this a holy day for you? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I believe in most of our lives we need to be taught what holy is even about. We have forgotten to take our lives and have it clean and to present it to You as a gift. We want our way and our time and how we do things. Today, Lord, let us learn how to use this day, not, yes, for Your glory, for Your honor, but also that we can be blessed by this day also. In Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen. Be seated, please. So we've learned, we've had a pattern, a routine that can help us so much. If you've done any kind of carpentry work or done something like this and you're going to be doing a lot of the same thing, it's good to have a little pattern to go by so you don't have to go back and measure it over and over and over again. A pattern to go by. This is what God has done with this day we have, the Sabbath day, this Sunday, as Jesus came and on that and blessed this day, the first day of the week, as we call it. And so we see blessings here that we have some benefits. For first, we have a pattern to prepare. We have a pattern to prepare. God designed us. He knows these bodies. He knows our limitations. Don't you love these young people, these children, and all they get to age? I can do this. I can do this. I can stay up all night long. And about 2 in the morning, they go boom, right over. They can't handle it. And what about us as we getting older, you know? As we're getting older, well, I can do the things I used to do. No, you can't. You got to get rest. And God wired us and knows all that. So not only did God know our bodies, God knows our tomorrows. As we were voting this past Tuesday, as many of you had voted already ahead of time, God already knew what Wednesday was going to be like, and Thursday, and Friday. And the way this election going, way it's going to be up until January 19th, I believe. God knows our tomorrows. He knows what we're going to be facing. That's why we need a Sabbath to prepare. We need to be able to prepare our minds, our minds? Do our minds need to be prepared? That's why we need the Word of God. But I know many of you, you rush through your Bible reading. You're doing it in the morning. Got to hurry. Got to get to work. Or you come home late in the evening. I've got to catch up on my Bible reading. That's why sometimes it's good to have a day, a Sabbath day. We can read God's Word and then actually listen to God. Listen to Him and what He has to say to us. You're under stress. I had a wellness check, telephone call this week. You older folks, you know what I'm talking about. And the lady is going through this thing and saying, sir, do you have any stress in your life? I said, ma'am, I'm married and I'm a preacher. You know what? She didn't even go any further with that. She just said, I understand, and clicked it off and went on. And so we think about this. All of us are under stress. Do y'all realize these children are under stress? These children, these youth, and these face masks, and social distancing, and how you do school, and how they're not doing school. Everything has changed for them. Thank goodness they can handle it better than we can, but it's still stress. And so all that's going through, so we need a time to prepare our minds. We also need to have a time to prepare our hearts. Our hearts. Prepare our hearts for what God is doing. Prepare our hearts for the hurts that's going to come. I want your life straight with the Lord. Be a follower of Jesus Christ. Be obedient to Him. Be in church every time. Marry the perfect person. Guess what? You're still going to get hurt. It's called life. Life. I got in trouble one time in church, and I'm getting age. I'm about to retire anyway, so let's go ahead, and I can get in trouble again. I said this years ago in a church, and boy, those little old ladies got so upset with me. I said, life is just one big, what'd I say, Kathy? One big dirty diaper. And I got in trouble at that church because I said the word diapers. Folks, but isn't it true? Isn't it true? Even with the blessings of life, we have struggles. And so God wants to prepare our minds. He wants to prepare our hearts. Also, prepare our hearts so we can forgive. Is it going to be hard to forgive some folks today? Things are being said. People are accusing. People are pointing. People said, well, we put up with this for so long, and now we got to do this for so long, and we're doing all this stuff. We're going to have to be a nation that learns how to forgive. And that's everybody. We also want to prepare our hearts so we can receive. God wants to bless us. God wants to bless us. But that's like that child that never wants to spend time with the parents. We need to spend time with our Father in heaven. We need to spend time with Him. And so also we have a pattern to grow. To grow. You did know you're supposed to grow as a believer, right? When you invited Jesus Christ in your heart, whether you were 15 or 35, 55, 75, you're supposed to mature as a believer. You're supposed to grow as a believer. You're not to be where you were. How many of you go back and look and say, well, I'm just like I was 20 years ago, spiritually. You got a growth problem. God wants you to take steps of faith. He wants you to get to the point where you take giant steps of faith for Him. So are you growing? We need to grow in obedience. In obedience. God gave us this wonderful example. He did not need a day of rest. But He gave us this example. Let's obey Him. And then Jesus came along. How many times do we see in the Scripture where Jesus pulled to the side and rested? Many, many times. Jesus could have walked and talked and 24/7. I think He could. But He gave an example to His disciples. And so let's do it in obedience. But we also need to grow in worship. We need to grow in worship. You say, well, I'm sitting here in this church. These chairs, they don't catch, you know, it hits my back and my leg and all that stuff. I'm not talking about that kind of worship. I'm talking about growing in the Lord in such a special way as you worship Him. I know people say, have you ever heard this? I know you. I've had it many times. I can worship the Lord by the lake. By the pond. By the river. By the ocean. Boy, that's a beautiful place to worship, isn't it? In the mountains. I can worship anywhere. And then here's a new thing I'm hearing. Oh, I'm worshiping because I can watch TV preachers for 4 straight hours. I'm a preacher and I can't watch preachers for 4 straight hours. But that's how they do it. Well, I watch this preacher and I watch this preacher and all this stuff. But folks, is that worship? That's teaching. And thank goodness we had that avenue of availability today. Thank goodness we have that availability, but that's not the worship I'm talking about. Unless I'm totally out of it, nobody say a word when I say that. Unless I'm totally out of it, as a part of my worship, as I read the Word of God, you know what I find? As I worship an almighty God, the Word of God pushes me, encourages me to take that step toward other believers. Other believers, but toward other believers. But not only does the Scripture tells me as I worship, as I spend time in the Word, as I in the Holy Spirit speaking to me, as I'm being blessed by the Word of God, that I am also to go out to lost people and lonely people, people that are hurting. And so worship does not make me see it. Worship tells me get up and go. Go and praise with my brothers and sisters in Christ. I want to tell you something. I'm realistic. I know this. Sometimes, if y'all graded my sermons, it'd be pitiful. Boy, he didn't even get a D- on that sermon today. But you walk out of this place, and you're encouraged, not by the Word of, well, yes, by the Word of God, but not by the preaching, but you looked over, and there was Brother Crocker back there, who's going through immune, and you looked at him and said, what an example to see this man here in the house of God. You're encouraged. You look at Smith, surgery on the elbow, on the wrist, and all this stuff wrapped up. And she's doing? She's here praising the Lord. How many of you have been through struggles? I mean, you lost a precious loved one. You could say, well, I'll never be back in the church. And you're here. You're ministering like you won't believe. Amen. See, we need each other to worship with others, the body of faith. Hebrews 10:25. Let's claim this, folks. Because I do have a fear. I do have a fear, and I'm turning this over to the Lord, that once this COVID-19 is over with, there's many people will never, never go to a house of worship. I don't care how big you build the building. I don't care how fancy it is. I don't care how many different programs it has. People are getting away from worship. Hour by hour by hour. Amen. Satan is telling them, you don't need the church. But Hebrews 10:25, not giving up meeting together as some are in the habit of doing. And isn't that what's happening today? Isn't that what happened? We're out of the habit of encouraging one another. And all the more as you see the day approaching. I mean, people have got this lined up already. Jesus is coming soon. I don't know. I don't know if Jesus is coming this week, today. But you know what? A train could get me today getting out of church. Huh? Something could happen on the way home. Sitting there watching whatever on TV this afternoon and this heart stops. I need to be ready. I need to be ready. That day approaching. Okay. And then we have a pattern to rest. We have a pattern to rest. Now, we all understand physical rest. We all need that. We all need that. But I'm not talking about just the physical rest. We need to rest in our doubts. Y'all do have doubts, don't you? You do question sometimes, don't you? Have you ever questioned? Does God really love me? Can God really save me? Have you ever questioned, can God keep me saved? You know, on our church website, we have a part there called sermons, and we got sermon, and we try to keep just about a year's worth of sermons on there and all, but when we see there's some sermons that's been going on for a good while that's doing pretty good, we kind of keep them going. And there's one sermon that's been more than any other sermon, and I preached it almost over 10 years ago. And the sermon title is, Can God Save My Soul? Would you believe little old Southside Baptist Church's website? And I know not everybody listened to the whole sermon. It doesn't matter. But in that one sermon, Can God Save My Soul?, we've had 7,127 hits. Hits on that as of this morning. Over 7,000 people wanting to know, can God save my soul? So you can find rest today in that assurance, of knowing that He can save you. So we can have rest in our doubts. We can rejoice with creation. God, He completed everything else. I mean, He everything. God created everything. He finished up. That's why He took the day. I'm finished. And then Jesus came and walked out of that grave on that Sunday, and He said, it's finished, folks. It's real. It's real. Yes, He said it on the cross. It is finished. But when He walked out of that grave, He put the stamp on it. He put the stamp on it. See, there's nothing else we can do. Nothing else we can do except invite Jesus into our hearts. Invite Jesus into our hearts. And then we can rest in our destination. In our destination. We can rest in knowing where we're going to spend eternity. Did anybody ever doubt? Am I saved? Am I going to heaven? Is this place where I'm going? Yes, you can rest in that destination. I don't know how they've done during the COVID-19 because I haven't seen the crowd there, but there's a place of worship. It's a cult that I drive by many times. And I see out there, oh, it's something else. They're there on Tuesday nights. They're there on Thursdays. They're there on Saturdays. They're there all day on Sunday and all this kind of stuff. And finally, I did a study on that particular faith, as they call it. And I found out the reason why they have such great attendance, that's how they earn the way to heaven. That's how they earn the way to heaven. It's basically required, if you're going to be a part of that particular faith, you got to attend 5 services a week. Some of you said, I'm going, no, don't say that, okay. 5 times, that's the way you earn your way to heaven. Folks, that's not true. We earn our way to, you know, where the truth is, we've earned our way to hell, haven't we? For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. We can't earn our thing. We have to trust the one that earned it for us. His name is Jesus. And trusting Him. And so this, trusting Him. Because of Jesus, we're going to heaven. But Sundays is just a dress rehearsal. That's what Sundays is all about. It's just a dress rehearsal. We think about it. Our destination is heaven. But I want to ask you something. Is there a chance, if you don't like worshiping God now, you may not enjoy worshiping Him for eternity? Is there a possibility? You know, you're going to have a lot of trouble in heaven if you don't like praising God now. You're going to have a lot of trouble in heaven if you don't like to be with the brothers and sisters in Christ. Because guess who's going to be there? Did y'all, oh, I'm sorry, y'all thought y'all had a private room, didn't you? Y'all thought y'all had a private room where you had, you call up and I need somebody to bring me some food. I'm here all by myself. Folks, what, we don't even have to worry about the mansions. Why are we going to be worrying about mansions when we're going to be walking those streets of gold trying to get closer to the throne as we worship of Almighty God? And so as we think about this, are we thinking that heaven's going to be a day of leisure? Are we thinking heaven is going to be my time, my way? It's His way. And He earned it, hadn't He? He created us. He formed us. He sent His Son for us. His Son died for us. We can spend eternity in heaven. So it's all about Him. See, we're going to be celebrating the goodness and the glory of God. The goodness and glory of God. Most middle-class Americans tend to worship their work, to work at their play, and to play at their worship. That's an interesting saying, isn't it? Most middle-class Americans tend to worship their work, to work at their play, and to play at their worship. Is that what it's all about? Convenience? Is worship nothing about, well, if I get around to it? Worship ought to be something that's 24/7. And then that point said, I want to go and be with my brothers and sisters in Christ. I want to share with them. I want to share the goodness of what God has done in my life. Yesterday, Catherine said she wanted to go yard sale. How some yard sales can end up at Hobby Lobby in Shelby. I mean, from a few yard sales in Gaffney, all of a sudden we're in Shelby and we're there at Hobby Lobby. We walk out and Emily was with us and she said, look at that smoke. And behind Hobby Lobby, there if you know where it's at, off of 74 in Shelby, the biggest, I mean, that thing was humongous, that smoke just bellowing it up. Well, we're trying to go out. Well, this road's kind of closed, and this road's kind of closed. And I said, okay, we're going to take a chance. So, well, Highway 74, there's those frontage roads. Well, we went edging our way down through there just trying to find a way to get out, trying to get back to home. And but we look, and what happened, we found out, was it's one of those car where you go and pull the car parts as you need it, an old-fashioned junkyard. But somebody was trying to pull apart an explosion. Guy did get hurt, not that bad. But if you know how those things are, those junk cars right there on top of each other, the fire just spread. It was something else. But here comes EMS had already gotten there. There was fire trucks coming from every direction. There was police blocking the different ways trying to get the trucks in. I mean, it was massive. I mean, they were pulling in people from all the volunteer fire departments. But I found out something. Did y'all know that our fire department guys actually... Y'all practice. Y'all get together and go through what to do in situations like that. And that's what I found out. They knew to get police officers at certain parts of that road and block traffic. They knew how far to get up. They knew where the fire hydrants were. They did all this stuff to get that fire out. I want to tell you something. We got a fire that's more dangerous than that fire I saw yesterday. It's called sin. It's called sin. And sin is running rampant. Sin is destroying lives today. Sin is destroying homes today. And I think you agree with me on this. Sin is destroying our nation. Yes. Amen. Destroying our nation. We need to make sure to practice worship. Not play worship, but practice worship. Getting into worship, turning to the Lord. Stop running from God. You don't want to listen to Him? Why not? He loves you. God loves you so much that He gave His only begotten Son. Nobody can beat that. He loves you that much. Why not give your heart to Him completely? Why not give your life to Him today? Are you going to let that fire continue to burn? That sin continue? Or today is the day you give your heart to Jesus? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, You've already been speaking to our hearts. I've looked into the eyes of many, and there's things that are going on. Disobedience. Not trusting You, not giving their life completely in worship to You. So I pray now, Lord, that this be a day they can walk out with hearts that are lifted, that they've walked out of this place encouraged, not that they're a better person, but they just trust the best God, the only God, the one true God. And I pray now that you just work during this time of invitation for those who want to just come and confess their sins, for those who want to come and rededicate their lives, that those who want to come and be a part of this church family, that you want to work in their lives, Lord. I just pray now. I pray for those that are burdened about families, loved ones, friends, co-workers that are lost in need of you, Lord. Lord, work during this time. Let us be in prayer for others. Let us be confessing our sins. Let us be trusting in you. Guide us through this time. In Jesus' name. Please stand. Wouldn't it be great if that's how it'd be every time that Jesus is, what, tenderly calling, right? Isn't that sweet? How many times, though, you find out Jesus is slapping you upside the head? Folks, he does it because he loves you. He's got a better plan for you. So why do we run? Why do we fight him? Just keep trusting in him. He's got great things for us. Let me remind you. The Christmas shoeboxes, we still got them back here at the table. Take them and fix them. They need to be back next week. Next week, we need to do it. If you don't get it back here next week, you got to take it down to First Baptist and put it in their truck yourself, okay? But be back, have that. Then let me see. The week after that is the Connie Maxwell Children's Home. Get those items. We're putting them in the tub over here. Got a nice little crowd of things, but we need some more stuff. And then I believe the week after that is the prisoner packs. I know we're hitting you all back to back to back like this, but please, if you can't do but one of them, it's worth it. But it'd be great if you could do all three of them. I tell you what, God's still working. God's still healing, right? Y'all do me a favor, remind yourself of it. Look at that person next to you and say, God is good. All the time? Okay, so as we close, Roger, good to have you back, brother. He's going to be back in the high school substitute teaching tomorrow. Are you teaching a PE or course? Ninth grade academy. Would you close us in prayer, please?